morning. Welcome to our medical student grand rounds. Our first presenter is here from the University of Utah School of Medicine, Matt Conley. Matt has been to 1/3 of all Spanish-speaking countries in the last 10 years and plans to get the rest of them, get up to 100% over the next 10 years. And today he will be presenting a case on acute retinal necrosis.
Jordan, thanks for that awesome introduction. I'm excited to kick off grand rounds today with an ocular emergency, something pretty interesting, acute retinal necrosis. I got to thank Dr. Shakur. This is one of his patients, and he's been pivotal in working through this case. So let's dive in. Day one, case starts out with a 47-year-old male waking up in the morning with periocular pain in his left eye. He also has a vision decrease and a headache. He goes to see his local optometrist and he started on prednisolone for anterior uveitis. He was seen 7 days later with no improvement. Day 13, the symptoms are still persisting regardless of treatment, and he's referred to the VAER and then subsequently the MRAM. His past ocular history is notable for LASIK in 2006, but no other recent eye surgeries or trauma. He has had VZV infection before with chickenpox and shingles. His family history is only pertinent for glaucoma, and his social history is pertinent for tattoos without swelling. He has multiple cats and has subsequently suffered several scratches from those cats. He's married with no recent international travel. His vital signs, his ocular vital signs show something very obvious, that decrease in visual acuity in the left eye. He went from 20/20 to 20/100. He also had a possible APD in his, but his pupils were fixed after post-dilation at the VA. On slip lamp exam, big things that stood out on this patient were the cell and flare in the anterior chamber and the edematous and slightly hyperemic disc and the cell and haze in the vitreous. Let's look at this retina right here. So you can see that 360-degree retinal whitening. This picture is pretty pretty impressive in a classic presentation of acute retinal necrosis, or ARN. You'll see that intraretinal hemorrhages here, and you also see the posterior pole is spared. There's also some folding coming off of the disc as well, and in OCT shows a little bit better. There was some optic disc edema and some macular edema as well. So after seeing this kind of presentation, etiologies that come to mind, or the differential diagnosis that comes to mind, is most likely for a viral retinitis. So you're looking at ARN, progressive outer retinal necrosis, as in porn, CMV retinitis, ocular syphilis, and other infectious etiologies. Because this presentation is pretty classic for ARN, I also wanted to go over real quickly what the other viral retinitis look like. So progressive outer retinal necrosis, unlike ARN, you'll see this in patients that are immunocompromised. ARN progresses really rapidly, but porn goes even faster, which is impressive. So also big difference between the two, on slit lamp exam in porn, you're going to see, you won't see vitritis as you'll see in ARN. And then the posterior pole is involved a lot faster because the disease progresses a lot faster. And here's a classic presentation of another one of Dr. Shakur's patients. So CMV retinitis, these patients are also immunocompromised. You will see a prominence of hemorrhage as compared to with ARN. a minimal vitritis, and also you will see posterior pole involvement a lot earlier on, and the periphery may be involved early as well. So acute retinal necrosis, epidemiology and etiology, kind of the basics. Let's start it out with this. This usually presents in patients that are 50 and 60 years old. This patient was about to hit his 50s. Most cases are caused by herpes viruses. The most common is VZV followed by HSV. There are some there are case studies that show that CMV and EBV can cause this pathology. The patients are usually immunocompetent, but can be immunocompromised. And as you guys saw, that this is kind of what makes it stand out compared to the other viral retinitis. Women and men are also affected equally. Acute retinal necrosis presents, as you saw, with this rapid onset of pain, vision loss, floaters, and photophobia. It usually presents in one eye, but will progress to binocular, to involve both eyes in most cases if left untreated. The vitritis is really common. As you saw in that photo, there's those small foci that are yellow and white, and they will come, they have those very discrete borders, but they will progress together rapidly if left untreated, and kind of coalesce together. The arteritis you'll see is pretty profound, and unlike CMV retinitis, there'll be few retinal hemorrhages. Also can see disc edema, optic neuropathy, and retinal detachment. Diagnosis with the presentation, most of the time it's just a clinical diagnosis, but further testing is required with an anterior chamber tap. You'll send that fluid off for VZV, HSV, and CMV, and toxoplasmosis PCR testing. It's interesting, atypical toxoplasmosis actually presents very similar to ARN and can be a mimicker. So it's something that you got to test for. Other testing considerations, if the history indicates, you can also get a CBC, CMP, and test for syphilis, tuberculosis, and other etiologies that would cause patient to be immunocompromised. The treatment for acute retinal necrosis is changing a little bit, but the conventional treatment is to use IV acyclovir for 5 to 10 days, and then to switch over to oral maintenance therapy for 6 weeks to 3 months, depending on how the patient progresses. In the last 5 years, several studies have shown that if you use oral Valtrex, you can get similar concentration in the body because of the great bioavailability of Valtrex. So this option is a lot cheaper and a lot more convenient for the patient and the healthcare system. So it's it's becoming more commonplace now. In patients that have severe disease, you will want really rapid treatment to stop the progression of the infection. So intravitreal antivirals are key. In key signs that will clue you in to use those are optic disc edema and macular involvement. So you can also use oral steroids after the first 2 days of antiviral treatment. Other really important things that you can decide to add on to patient therapy is antiplatelet therapy to prevent ischemic damage to the retina and optic nerve. And additionally, you can use topical steroids if you have interior chamber involvement in panuveitis. The major goal of treatment is to spare the unaffected eye, considering how many complications you will have in the if infected eye. So this case, protocol was followed, AC tap was sent for the following, and it came back positive for the most classic culprit, VZV. The rest were negative. The assessment for this patient was ARN with panuveitis secondary to VZV. Important distinctions was there was no neurological involvement. This patient was immunocompetent, and there was 360 degrees of peripheral retina involvement and disc edema. So for that particular presentation, you want to hit it with the full treatment, and that's what we did. As you can see, these are the medications we started, or that the team started, and they added in the intravitreal injection to stop the progression of the disease. So as I said, acute retinal necrosis is an ocular emergency and can have many complications. As outlined here, the most common is a retinal detachment. This will happen in 70% of cases. And it happens because of the pathophysiology of the disease. The necrosing retina creates these holes in the retina, which allow fluid to go to enter in and separate the retina and cause this detachment. So this is exactly what happened with this patient. 2 months after initial presentation, they showed up with new flashes, floaters, and vertical and horizontal photopsias. Their visual acuity decreased from 20/100 to hand motion only in the left eye. And on their exam, they showed inferior detachment extending into the macula, which I'll show you here. So you can see that in this image, there's this nice border here of this retinal detachment, classic presentation, and hard to treat with these patients because of the inflammation that's already happening in the eye. Here's the OCT demonstrating the severity of the detachment as well. So management in this case was classic. Patient underwent retinal detachment repair with vitrectomy, scleral buckle, and silicone oil placement, as well as endolaser. 3 months later, patient returned to the OR for follow-up and to remove the oil, and also had developed a cataract considering the inflammation and the steroids that the steroid treatment they've been on. So they had a cataract and IOL placement. The current status of this case, on Friday, we saw this patient together, and a year after the original insult, the patient's left eye has decreased the hand motion, only visual acuity. But OCT has showed that the macular edema has been resolved, although there's some temporal atrophy. In the right eye, it has been spared thus far, which is a great relief. And its visual acuity is still 20/20. We've continued valcyclovir treatment so that to prevent further progression of the disease. This is the OCT photos, or sorry, the photos of the retina. As you can tell, this is very significant for fibrosis in the periphery with laser scarring, and it's pretty impressive the amount. It's pretty impressive what ARN can do to a patient. The key takeaways from this case is always dilate the pupil when you see anterior uveitis. Earlier treatment can save vision and also prevent progression to the other eye. Huge thank you to Dr. Shakur, Dr. Orozco, Patel, Altman, and Bear for your help taking care of this patient, and also with your guidance in this presentation. Also, thank you to the Marin photographers for providing those awesome photos. These are my references, and we'll leave it open for a couple questions in the last couple minutes. So delays in treatment cause progression to the other eye that is not involved. So binocular involvement, and then also if you treat it earlier, you can prevent retinal detachment just because there'll be less retinal holes. With that being said, though, barricade laser is really controversial. And so that is not necessarily a preventative treatment because it doesn't necessarily prevent retinal detachments. It's kind of a, it follow the treatment guidelines and hope that there's no detachment. And hopefully you caught it enough, early enough for that there's no holes and no detachment.
Thank you, Matt. So our next presenter, Madison Perchik, when she was a kid, was on a trip to Costa Rica and mistook a saltwater crocodile for a log, classic mix-up, and was almost eaten, but was not. And with her newfound life, went to the University of Tennessee College of Medicine. And now she is joining us here at the Moran to discuss a case of UGG, a complex patient presentation. Thanks.
Good morning. I might or might not need help pulling up my presentation. Let's see how this. Oh, maybe not. Great. Thank you. Good morning, everyone. My name is Madison Perchik. Thank you so much, Jordan, for the introduction. It's a true story about the crocodile. I'm so excited to be with you all this morning. And my talk is called, Ugh, a Complex Patient Presentation. So let's get started. Alrighty, so our patient is a 49-year-old female currently, and she has a past medical history relevant for Marfan syndrome. So the first encounter that I could find with this patient in Epic was in 2013. At that visit, she was said to be aphakic on the right, and she was symptomatic from a dislocated capsular bag with phimosis. That same year in 2013, she was also diagnosed with myopic degeneration, OU. And then in 2014, she underwent an anterior PPV, a lensectomy, and then a sutureless three-piece scleral fixated IOL. And this top picture on the left is a picture of her retina, which shows IOL tilt and also scleral show, which is common in high myopes. And then the bottom picture is an OCT that is consistent with her myopic degeneration. So a little more about her. After that procedure that she had in, or surgery that she had in 2014, she did have an episode of postoperative microhyphema. And after that episode, she really was pretty quiet until around 2019. That's when she started having more issues. So in 2019, she started to have some recurrent microhyphemas. And in that same year, she had her first episode of inflammation. She came to Moran and said that her right eye felt like when she woke up that she was waking up from a steam room. So she was found to have uveitis, and she had reactivated uveitis about once a year since then. But subjectively, she said in the last year or so that it's been worse, they've lasted longer, and they've been more difficult to treat. Additionally, with these episodes of uveitis, she's also had intraocular pressure spikes that are semi-concurrent with these uveitis flares. So it seemed to be responsive to the steroids that were being used to treat her uveitis. And since then, she's been on both steroids and intraocular pressure lowering drops, and the optimization of which has been ongoing because as they have tried to decrease her inflammation with steroids, that increases her intraocular pressure many times. So that optimization has been difficult. And notably, she also had an episode of herpetic keratitis in 2020 that was treated with oral Valtrex. And then this picture on the left depicts data from Epic. That this line graph was pretty cool, I thought, that Epic gave it to us. And the top line, the blue line, is her intraocular pressure from 2019 to now. And then the bottom line is her right eye's distance vision without correction. So I just show this to say that you can see that she had a few spikes of intraocular pressure in 2019 on that way left side. But you can see in the last year, she's had a lot more problems with it, and that has correlated with a decrease in her distance vision as well in that right eye. So the differential diagnosis for her at this point was UG syndrome versus chronic herpetic uveitis. And the uveitis team was consulted for help in the rest of this workup. So her labs were notable for a positive ANA, but the uveitis team was not super worried about RA or lupus, as she didn't show any more systemic signs of these conditions. And they did note that her inflammation recurred even on Valtrex 1 gram TID, which should have been plenty of Valtrex to treat chronic herpetic uveitis. So that kind of leaned them away from that picture. And lastly, they did an AC tap, which was negative for the viral PCR, which was kind of the final step to lean away from that chronic herpetic uveitis. And then in 2019, a UBM or an ultrasound biomicroscopy scan showed haptic ciliary body touch. And then this picture on the left is from a study that I found that I thought did a nice job of pointing out these little arrows are representations of where the haptic is and it touching different parts of the uveal tissue. And then this is a picture from Moran of our patient with her haptic against her ciliary body. So because of this whole picture, looking at everything, the recurrent uveitis, the increase in intraocular pressure, the microhyphemas, the UBM results, and that negative viral PCR, the most likely diagnosis for her at this point was UG syndrome. So in 2022, she had an IOL explantation, and she's still aphakic right now. And she had an ab interno viscocanalostomy and a gonioscopy assisted transluminal trabeculotomy, all on the right side. And her pre-op distance vision without correction was 2060, and her intraocular pressure the day before surgery was 41. And at post-op week one, she was hand motion on that right eye. And then at post-op week two, her distance without correction was 2100. She did pinhole to 2060. And her IOP has been much improved. Her last visit was 16, but she does still have 3+ cell. So she's still on oral and topical steroids at this point. She is on PO Valtrex, and she is on COSOP BID still. Her glaucoma or intraocular pressure lowering drop regimen has decreased a lot. She was on a combination of, I think, 4 oral and drop medications for her intraocular pressure. So that's improved a lot. So this patient has just abundant, fascinating features of her ocular history. I think I could do 10 rounds or 10 grand rounds of just this patient, but I did want to focus the rest of my time on this most likely differential that is uveitis glaucoma hyphema syndrome. So this syndrome was first coined by Ellingson in 1978. He described it as a complication of intraocular lens implants causing a mechanical chafing. And the pathophysiology of this is that you have this contact of this intraocular lens with uveal tissue that causes inflammation or uveitis. It also causes erosion of that tissue. So the blood aqueous barrier is broken down, which causes release of pigmented cells, red blood cells, and white blood cells into the AC. And so if you have red blood cells in the AC, that would be your microhyphema. And then all of these cells can work together kind of to clog up the trabecular meshwork and cause that increased intraocular pressure that we see with this syndrome. And UG syndrome is most commonly caused by AC IOLs or 3-piece sulcus IOLs, but they actually can occur with any type of pseudophakic lens, even in the back. So how do we diagnose UG syndrome? As you can tell from this patient, it's not always super straightforward. It can take years. It's a chronic syndrome. These signs and symptoms that we see do not always happen at the same time. And these patients can have a lot of other things going on as well. So a high index of suspicion is really important. But on exam, we look for things such as, of course, the microhyphemas, increased intraocular pressure, signs of inflammation like cell and flare or hypopyons. We can look for iris neovascularization or iris transillumination defects, which is shown in the picture on the left. And we also look for malpositioned lenses or haptics. It can even cause vitreous hemorrhage or CME as well. If you are thinking about UG syndrome in your differential, it's also important to go neo the patient in order to look for blood within the angle and hyperpigmentation of the trabecular meshwork and signs of mechanical erosion. And then lastly, like we've we've been talking about, UBM is also a mainstay of diagnosis, and it's used to confirm the position of the lens and the haptics and its contact or lack of contact with the uveal tissue. So lastly, the treatment of UG syndrome. If you can imagine a mechanical kind of chafing of the haptic or the lens on any kind of uveal tissue, it's probably not going to fix itself. So additional surgical intervention is often the most effective treatment. So whether that is in the form of repositioning or explanting or exchanging the lens, those are the most definitive treatments. But in the meantime, again, because this is a lot of times not kind of a home run diagnosis and it can take years, if it's even on your differential, there are a lot of medical treatments that can be done in the meantime to treat the patient. So for the uveitis, it's recommended to give them topical or oral corticosteroids to help decrease their inflammation. For the intraocular hypertension or glaucoma, of course, we have oral and drop medications that can decrease the intraocular pressure. It is interesting that we don't usually use prostaglandin analogs in this case because they have been linked to inflammation. And then lastly, for hyphema, you can recommend that the patient decreases their activity, does head elevation, uses cycloplegics, and then also topical steroids, which if they have a uveitis flare at the same time, they might already be on. And that is all I have. I hope that this case was interesting and that it was a good little concise review of UG syndrome for all of you. And I just wanted to take a moment and say thank you to everyone for your time today. And I've had such an incredible experience at Moran. Everyone has been so welcoming to me and I've learned so much. And thank you to Moran for the photographers as well. Those pictures are awesome. So thank you so much. And I'm happy to try to answer any questions you may have. And Dr. Mamlis, if you're unmuted, then you can go right ahead. Thank you.
It was interesting when UG was first described by Ellingson, it was very poorly finished anterior chamber IOLs causing UG syndrome. And we see this often in three-piece lenses put in the sulcus, but also one-piece lenses put in the sulcus, which should never be used. What would be interesting now is to see if UG will recur following scleral fixated IOLs using the Yamani technique. And I've not seen a case yet, but it would be very interesting because the haptics are not rubbing on the ciliary sulcus, they're actually going through the ciliary sulcus, but it'd be interesting to see with the Yamani technique if we start to get any issues of UG syndrome with the peripheral optic of the IOL rubbing on either the ciliary sulcus or the posterior iris. I'm not aware of cases that have been reported. I don't know if anybody else has heard cases of UG syndrome following Yamani surgery.
The audience says yes, that they have seen it before. Okay. For the people on Zoom, that they have seen it with specifically with when the IOL is tilted. Yes, please. I'm sure you can explain it.
So one of the great resources in today's medicine is these blogs that people are on, and you can kind of get the ASCRS listserv, and for cornea specialists, you get CARINET. And so there's a lot of people that are doing complex anterior segment surgery in that forum. And Yamani is not 100% foolproof at preventing sort of recurrence of UG. There are cases where they've used, I don't know what we call them. They're not endoscopes, but what do we call them? Where you actually can look back there with a scope at the ciliary body and kind of see where these haptics are kind of going through there. And there are cases where the haptics are actually still rubbing within that ciliary body. And then in a lot of cases, it is lens tilt issues and iris kind of floppiness. So the recommendation is to have a PI to try to keep the iris a little bit away from the lens if you can, and trying to avoid tilt so that your entry points on Yamani are equal and equidistance from the iris as well. But yeah, definitely not foolproof as a go-to to say we're going to get rid of UG by taking the lens out and doing Yamani. But
yeah.
So Nick, this question's kind of directed to you a little bit. Rachel is asking Jacoby, Dr. Jacoby, if anybody's used the Apple Miyake view technique to look at a Yamani surgery to kind of see where these haptics are going and what's happening during that surgery?
You know, when our dear colleague Alan Crandall was alive, he and Bob Cioni did some Miyake eyes with us when the Yamani technique was first coming out to actually look at the placement. And what we found is that it was a small series. It wasn't a large series of eyes, but we found that the placement of the haptics was variable. And I think as our techniques have improved and people are getting better at marking exactly where you're, you know, putting these haptics now, that has gotten better, but still there's a lot of variability in where those haptics actually end up. And if they do go too far anterior or tilt, as you mentioned, then you can get issues with UGG syndrome still. And so I think the key thing to prevent that right now is making sure that you have even placement of those haptics and that those haptics are placed far enough back from the iris that they're not going to cause any significant chafing with that optic that could cause UGG syndrome.
Okay, our next presenter, Parker Cox, is also joining us from the University of Utah School of Medicine by way of Colorado. Speaking of blogs, he runs a food blog with his wife called Your Cup of Cake. I was on it this morning. It's extremely impressive. Lots of one-pot meals for the busy people out there. And more recently, he's been cooking up a case review of acute corneal hydrops.
Perfect. No worries. All right. Well, thank you, Jordan. Today I'll be talking about acute corneal hydrops. And I've broken up my presentation into two primary categories. First, just going over brief case review. And then second, a general overview of acute corneal hydrops. I don't have any disclosures to make today, so we'll just jump right in. So the patient that I'll be discussing today is a 46-year-old male who has a history of keratoconus bilaterally. He did have a penetrating keratoplasty on the left side. Due to the keratoconus, and he had multiple cases of rejection of that graft, treated primarily with steroids. He initially presented in March of 2021, complaining of a week of what he described of clouding in his eye. He also had some photophobia, significant tearing, foreign body sensation, stabbing pain, and dryness just in that right eye. He was using artificial tears, but said that he was not experiencing any relief. It's also important to note that he was having no symptoms in his left eye. I did include some keratometry of his right eye. This is, however, from 2019, so 2 years prior to his presentation. We see some pretty significant steepening of the inferior cornea. He has some pretty high K values and some pretty high astigmatism, all consistent with keratoconus. Other history worth noting, he does have a medical history of migraine, hyperlipidemia, gout and hypertension. Family history is significant in his father for keratoconus as well, who also has glaucoma and had a stroke, mother with a history of heart disease. His social history is rather insignificant with the exception of being a former smoker. That corneal transplant took place in 2006, and he had been using a scleral lens since then. He had previously tried rigid gas permeable lenses with minimal success. So he, at this presentation, in 2021, his visual acuity was pretty poor. He was only able to visualize hand motions only. He did have pinhole vision at 2200. Left eye was seeing completely normal, no afferent pupillary defect. The IOPs were normal bilaterally, and movement of the eyes were normal bilaterally. On the slit lamp exam, his right conjunctiva was pretty injected. Left was normal, however. He had about a 6.5 millimeter area of edema centrally in the right cornea, as well as some infracentral microcystic edema on that side. On the left, as I had mentioned, he had had a corneal graft. There were no sutures in place. There was a little bit of inferior scarring, and he had 360 degrees of pannus with vasculature limited just to the graft host junction. On that right eye, the fundus was unable to be visualized due to the clouding of the cornea from that edema. And the remainder of the slit lamp exam was normal. So he was diagnosed with acute corneal hydrops. These pictures on the right side of the screen are not from our patient, but just shown for visual representation. He was managed with prednisolone, cyclopentolate, hypertonic saline drops, as well as serial follow-up every 4 to 6 weeks for several months. Ultimately, prednisolone was decreased and the cyclopentolate was discontinued, as well as the Miro. His visual acuity was improving with the use of a contact lens, and he was recommended that he has plans for a future keratoplasty on that right side. So his clinical course, after all of this follow-up over the course of about a year and a half, he presented to clinic about 2 weeks ago, reporting that his symptoms have been greatly improved. He does continue to experience a little bit of photophobia and some light sensitivity, likely due to the scattering of light through that scar. This picture on the right side of the screen above is a picture of his cornea, which you can tell there is some notable scarring, as well as a vertical tear in Desmase membrane here indicated by the arrows. However, as I mentioned, his visual acuity was improving. He sees roughly 20/20 to 20/40 with the use of a scleral lens. The slit lamp exam showed some apical scarring. However, there's no edema. And then I also included keratometry from this most recent visit, just to note that he still continues to have some steepening of that inferior cornea, no changes in his astigmatism. So for him, long-term management includes just continual follow-up every 6 months, continued use of that scleral lens, and then future plans for a possible keratoplasty of the right side. So now I'll transition and just talk about a general overview of ACH. It's important to note that it falls into a category of corneal ectatic diseases and is primarily seen in patients with keratoconus, and up to 3% of patients or 2.8% of patients with keratoconus can be seen. However, it also can occur in patients with keratoglobus and pellucid marginal degeneration. It's most commonly seen in male patients more than females, and typically between the ages of 20 and 40. Risk factors include atopic diseases, eye rubbing, and steep keratometry, which we saw in our patient. There has been a few studies indicating correlation with learning disorders as well as Down syndrome. And then as far as the pathophysiology, the primary cause here is a tear in the Desmase membrane and endothelium, which causes an influx of the aqueous humor into the stroma and occasionally the posterior part of that stroma, causing edema. This picture on the right side of the screen shows just that, a pretty significant tear here in the central area of the Desmase membrane vertically, as well as edema due to that flow of aqueous humor through that defect. I've included a couple of histological pictures just to show what that looks like. Here we see some pretty significant apical thinning of the stroma of the cornea. On this side, we have an image of a patient with a cornea stained with trichrome stain, showing a defect in the Bowman's layer, indicated by the arrow here. And then this picture at the bottom here, E, demonstrates a patient who had a previous ACH, and you see the Desmase membrane kind of rolled up here at the edges, which can be kind of seen in a chronic patient who's not healed well. As far as diagnosis of ACH, typically we rely on the physical exam, in which decreased visual acuity is common in almost every patient. You may notice an artificially low IOP due to the corneal edema in the patient. And then CITL testing can be beneficial, primarily just to differentiate whether or not the aqueous humor is flowing through that break of the Desmase membrane versus a corneal penetration. And then as far as diagnosing with imaging modalities, I've included a picture of anterior segment OCT. This can be helpful just to visualize a break in the DM, as well as here we see into the posterior stroma. It can also be helpful for chronic follow-up of patients just to visualize how well they are healing, whether or not the DM has reattached, and the presence of scarring as well. In vivo confocal microscopy can be particularly beneficial to visualize at the cellular level some of the damage caused, and primarily whether or not there are inflammatory cells. Patients who have inflammatory cells present for greater than 4 weeks have an association or increased likelihood of having neovascularization, which can complicate long-term management. And then of course, tomography, which I've included just to show how the tear in the Desmase membrane can affect changes in corneal thicknesses, both on the inside and outside. And so as far as management, medical management is our mainstay treatment because most cases resolve on their own in about 2 to 4 months. As far as pharmacological measures, typically we will rely on ocular antihypertensives, cyclopegics, steroids, and antibiotics. As you'll note from our patient, we use steroids, cyclopegics, and the hypertonic saline. Surgery is needed, usually in patients with pretty significant tear of the decimus membrane, in which we can use air and gas for a, I don't know if I'll say this right, but a pneumatic disseminopexy to kind of help alleviate some of that greater tearing. The downside to this is patients are required to lay in a supine position for a prolonged period, and there is an increased risk for complications. However, compression sutures can be used as well for patients who are unable to tolerate the supine position. And then, of course, as I mentioned in our patient, relying on a future plan for a penetrating keratoplasty in that one side. This is the mainstay in treatment for patients with keratoconus, seem to have pretty positive outcomes, such as the patient that I presented today. I just want to give a special thanks to Dr. Amy Lin and Dr. Dina Kirschenbaum for helping me find this interesting case and give me some direction on some resources to learn from. I'd be happy to answer any questions today, or here's my email if there's questions that come up afterwards. Thanks so much.